Welcome back, everybody, to another episode of Puppet Masters and Castle Freaks, the internet's leading all things Charles Band podcast. I am one of your hosts, Jared Hornbeck, and if I was in one of those lame slasher movies, I would be dead now. And I am not the only person who is running along this secluded beach. I see someone else there, and oh, he tackled me.
Sorry, I just had to do it. I'm Steve Guntley, and if stuff would happen in this town, I wouldn't have to read comic books to make things happen. This is the podcast about kooky morticians, snake tongues, and fake seances. That's because this is the podcast about Witch House 2, Blood Coven, and Witch House 3, Demon Fire. That's right. We are completing the Witch House cycle. We are finishing out the series, and it has taken a dramatically different direction, which is very cool. And we also we get the rare opportunity to talk with someone who I would say was somewhat involved with the making of these movies, maybe a tiny bit. Who's joining us today?
Yeah, so we have a really exciting guest to talk about these two Witch House movies with us. He is the author of the wonderful book B-Movies in the 90s and Beyond, which is a really fascinating insight into what it takes to get these indie movies made. He has been a producer and director on so many projects to the point where he was dubbed by Dave J, and it came from the video aisle, as the patron saint of micro-budget movies. I'm talking, of course, about J.R. Bookwalter. J.R., man, what's going on? Thanks for taking the time to join us.
Hey, guys. Thanks for having me.
Oh, we're talking
about my two Witch House movies.
I can't imagine why you would be so excited. I think we may have...
I'm a little partial to these two.
Well, we may have lost that in the shuffle here, but J.R. is the director of both of these films, which is pretty fucking cool. We don't get the opportunity to talk about movies directly with the person who made them very often, and so it's very cool. And it's especially cool with movies that are kind of shot at this budget and this level in this time period where a lot of people didn't really bother to document it. And, so our research was a lot of... there wasn't a lot written about these movies, unfortunately, but we get to talk to the person who is very directly involved in making it. And you can tell us about production and all of that.
We did this one other time, having the director of a movie on, and his name is going to come up in this episode.
That's true. Yes. Yeah. It doesn't come up very often, but we're very excited to have you, and we're very excited to witness at least. So we're going to be a little brutally honest about our feelings about the first Witch House movie, which no disrespect to Dave DeCoto, but it was one that we struggled with a little bit. And so we were excited to watch these two and see a bit of a redemption arc for this series. I think over the course of 2 and 3, they are much different beasts than the first one time around. And they're very visually dynamic and propulsively paced in a way that the first one unfortunately wasn't. I hope I'm not talking out of school. Were you a fan of the first Witch House when you saw it?
Well, I mean, I was a post-production supervisor at that point for Full Moon. I was, very intimately involved in the post process, which was, if you want to talk about it, was like that baby came out sideways, because Dave had come back from Romania with that footage, and we did a first cut of it, and Charlie Band wasn't very happy with it. So Charlie actually, in a rare case of him coming and sitting in, it was him and Dave DeCoto that both sat in with the editor trying to make the thing work. And we were throwing pretty much everything but the kitchen sink in post-wise, trying to make it, what it wound up being, a lot of visual effects and all that kind of stuff. So, yeah. I mean, like I said, it's not my favorite Witch House movie. It's certainly not my favorite movie.
We tried to give credit to the, that one did, it was talked about in Dave J's book about being one of the more difficult production cycles, of a Full Moon movie of that era. And so, they had some elements working against it, which we try to give credit to as well.
Yeah. And no disrespect to Dave DeCoto. Like, Dave, we love you. You made a ton of stuff. Like, we've definitely praised work that you've done. You are a prolific man. You have done so many of these movies, but Steve mentioned like a redemption arc, and I do feel like I'm not talking out of school by saying like these movies succeeded more on the strength of just not being Witch House 1.
Well, I mean, it's a weird trilogy, because it's none of the movies have any relation to the other movies.
Right.
Which I think is to its betterment. If I'm being honest, I think that is a selling point.
Yeah, other than having that Lilith character. I mean, you really, the first movie, you know, to Dave's credit, and Dave was really cranking out movies for Full Moon at that point. So, you know, this is just one of many that he was doing. I mean, he did a very Night of the Demons inspired take on Witch House. I mean, that's essentially what it was. Night of the Demons with witches. The second one is was a little more inspired by Blair Witch. The third one was, I don't know what the inspiration for that was, but they all came from different backgrounds.
Yeah.
So background is an interesting word, JR, and I want to talk a little bit about your background because you're somebody who has spent a long time working within low budget into micro budget. So I want to know, you know, when did this really, like, when did your interest in becoming a filmmaker start? Like, when did you first realize that this was an interest of yours? And then I would love to kind of know if we then you include a little bit about The Dead Next Door, which is I find to be like a really fascinating project, and you devote like four chapters in the B Movies in the 90s and Beyond book to it, the whole process of getting that thing done. And it seems like something that you were just proud to be able to tell the story about. Like, how did that then sort of dovetail into you being I don't want to say discovered, but like catching the attention of Charles Band to then start shepherding in the Tempe era projects?
Well, I think the four chapters on Dead Next Door was because it took 4 years to make. So it's like one chapter per year. But no, I mean, I blame my mother for my interest in horror, because she claims after I was born, she was home with me. And this was in the late 60s when there were a lot of soap operas, and Dark Shadows was very popular at the time. And she was watching that show with me as an infant. So I like to blame it on her that was my first interest in horror. After that, I was really more into like Godzilla movies and science fiction and all that kind of stuff. Star Wars was really the movie that made me want to actually go out and make movies. I mean, when I saw that at the right age, I was 11 years old when it first came out. And so from that point on, my friend and I would, you know, we would get together and make these little badly animated Star Wars ripoffs with our action figures. We were essentially making like our own sequels, like Darth Vader Lives and all, you know, this was in that window between Star Wars and Empire Strikes Back.
Sure.
Where kids would just go nuts, like trying to think of all the stuff that you can do, you know, with that stuff. So sci-fi was really my first love until I discovered Dawn of the Dead and in the pages of Fangoria number one. And that sort of, when I saw those pictures of all of Tom Savini's great makeup effects, it just sort of, something in me snapped. And then it became like, how can I get all the neighbor kids and the pets and all this stuff and just cover them in fake blood, ketchup or whatever. And making a lot of like little splatter short films. So I was making Super 8 short films from 10 or 11 years old, all the way through high school and even into college. And obviously my first feature, The Dead Next Door, also wound up being shot on Super 8. So I continued it even into my early or late teens, I should say, because that movie, I started it when I was 19 and finished it when I was an old man, no, 23. So yeah, I mean, it was, that was really the arc of how I got into it in the first place. I mean, how I wound up, how it led to Charlie Band's doorstep is sort of a long story, but the short version of it is I blame it all on Dave Dakota, because Dave Dakota, I had made a bunch of movies for him, for his cinema home video company. And when I had moved to California for the second time in 1997, he was about to make a movie called Shrieker for Full Moon. He hadn't worked for Charlie in a while, but he was coming back to it. And I was finishing doing post work on a movie that two Wisconsin filmmakers had made called Sleepwalker, which actually ironically wound up being bought by Full Moon and released as Vengeance of the Dead. So that technically fits in the theme of what we're talking about.
That might come up on the show. Yeah.
Yeah, so that was a 16mm movie, and for some reason, you know, I had done a lot of these shot on video movies and different things on different formats, and Dakota, you know, I think it triggered something in him when he saw me finishing this stuff on a 16mm movie that I might be the person that should edit and do the sound mix for his movie that he was about to make for Charlie. So that was Shrieker, and that was my first foray. Now, he didn't tell Charlie Band anything about me. They had no idea who I was. I was working out of my apartment in North Hollywood, and they were over the hill in Hollywood. And he was just, I was just sort of this weird secret until we had a cut that he was ready to show them. So then I lugged all my equipment across the hill to Full Moon's Hollywood and Vine offices and sat with Dave Dakota, Charlie Bannon, and Charlie's father, Albert. And we basically locked the edit, and they were so happy with what I had done that then that sort of led me to get hired on Curse of the Puppet Master as an editor and eventually become their post-production supervisor. So yeah, that's kind of how path to Full Moon.
You were kind of Mr. Fix-It for a long time at Full Moon. You were the guy kind of behind the scenes, like polishing up these movies that have had to have kind of low budgets and very quick turnaround time. That cannot have been an easy gig.
Well, it ranged. It varied. When it started, they had shot a bunch of these kids movies in Romania that had, there was a problem with one of the film magazines that it scratched a bunch of the negative. So,
okay.
That was one of the early things I did once Charlie realized that I could do this stuff is he would send all this footage over and we were having to the guy that I was working with was having to remove scratches from it. So that's kind of how that whole thing started. And then they had another post supervisor and I eventually within the space of, the next 6 or 8 months over that, the guy was out of a job and I was put in his position.
JR, can I ask you, the movie you're talking about where you had to fix the scratches, was that Frankenstein Reborn?
Well, no, that actually, there was some of it on that too, because that was shot during that time period. It was Clockmaker and a lot of those Pulse Pounder's kids movies. But Frankenstein Reborn was that one that I actually... After I had cut Shrieker and Curse of the Puppet Master, that was the third thing I was hired to cut. And I got so busy overseeing the post that I only could cut the first, I think, half of it. And then I had the two guys that I had mentioned before who had made Sleepwalker, Don Adams and Harry Picardi, they wound up finishing that for me because I think Talisman was another one that I was supposed to cut around that time. And I just simply didn't have any more time to sit and actually edit anything because I was overseeing everything.
You mentioned Romania, JR, and really, the Full Moon era in Romania came to an end essentially with the first movie we're going to talk about here today. So Steve, why don't you fire off a couple stats about our first film?
Absolutely. Yes, the first film we are talking about today is called Witch House 2 Blood Coven. It was released here on September 26, 2000. It's directed by J.R. Bookwalter, and it's written by Douglas Snaufer, and it stars Ariana Albright, Elizabeth Hobgood, Nicholas Lanier, Casey Shank, Alexandru Dragoi, and Andrew Prine. Now, we talked about the late, great Andrew Prine a little bit when we covered his performance as the mercenary Harry Fontana in Eliminators. Were you a fan of Eliminators when you cast him in this part?
Oh, yeah. I mean, all that. I grew up with all that Empire stuff. So,
yeah.
My biggest Andrew Prine movie was Grizzly. That was the one that I grew up in the entire time. Because I had seen that so many times on late night TV as a kid. And when his name came up as the possibility of maybe being in this thing, I just went bananas. I was like,
"You said I love it so much, I'm going to cast him in two roles."
Oh,
exactly. That was the challenge of it because he really had to be somebody that had the gravitas to sort of carry those two roles and make that switch. So it was not an easy feat.
Yeah.
But man, he just made it look. He made it look very easy because he just showed up and was like, "Yeah, there's no problem. I can do this." It was something he actually hadn't done before. So
yeah.
That was, unique to his filmography, his very extensive filmography.
Yeah, he was very, very fun in Eliminators, and you can go back in his early career. He was in like The Miracle Worker and a lot of Tony prestigious projects, and he has fun in these B-movie roles, and he's really good at them. And another casting choice I wanted to ask you about was Ariana Albright. I'm curious where you found her because I had so much fun with her performance in this. I think she was in the first Witch House briefly as Lilith. She's carrying the role over, but that was a relatively small part. She kind of showed up towards the end of the film, but she's all over this one. She's playing multiple characters and she just has a really fun kind of like burlesque energy to her performance that I'm really enjoying. And I'm looking at her filmography and I see that she actually was in Vengeance of the Dead, the Sandman movie that you referenced earlier. Is this where you first kind of encountered her and just kind of remembered her?
No, we met at a Fangoria weekend of horrors convention and actually wound up dating after that.
But
she was an aspiring actress and she basically started with me. I mean, I had made a movie called The Sandman in 1995, and it was at the time I met her, it wasn't quite finished yet. So I, with her encouragement, I was actually a movie that I was going to put on the shelf and not finish and walk away from. She was the one that sort of watched it and said, "Are you nuts? You got to finish this." So that's kind of how she wound up as a model on the cover, even though she's not in that movie. She's got a voice cameo in it or whatever. But then she, we made Polymorph in 1996 and Bloodletting in 1996. Those were the two movies that we made in Ohio before moving out to Los Angeles. So she knew Dave Dakota through me, and which is how she wound up getting cast as Lilith in the first Witch House. But she was also, I don't remember if at the time of Witch House 2, I don't think she was working at Full Moon, but she at one point did work in the post department at Full Moon, and she was obviously involved in a lot of the stuff that was
going on. Well, she did do something with Full Moon, and this will be a slight tangent, and then we can come back to talking about her and her performance, which I had a lot of fun with also. She does have an appearance in The Dead Hate the Living.
Oh,
which yes. is directed by Dave Parker, who friend of the show, Dave Parker, who is on who was the other director I was alluding to before, who was on our show talking about The Dead Hate the Living.
Yeah.
And I will say I recognized him immediately as the drunk on the street being interviewed during the like camcorder footage of Witch House 2. And also RIP Bill Burr.
Jeff Burr, yeah. Ted Newsom.
I combined Bill Butler and Jeff Burr in my head just now. Two names that have come up a million times. But Jeff Burr, I meant to say, also being interviewed on the street, which was really fun. But those two guys, I saw them. Like when Dave Parker started talking, it took me a second and I'm like, wait a second, I know that voice. I feel like I've had a conversation with that man before. But she has a role in Dead Hate the Living as well. So she was, I think, you know, at least tangentially still kind of around Full Moon at that time. But I agree with Steve. I think her performance definitely is a highlight of the first movie. And like I had to even do some like, I think thinking back to our Witch House episode, which was a while ago now, it was one of the things I think we praised a little bit in the first movie, but so much time has passed and that movie left so little of an impression on me that I forgot she was in it. And I on IMDb, I had to go back and I was like, oh, wait a minute. She was Lilith in the first movie too, but she definitely stood out to me in this one. Like, and so that's
great makeup in the first one and really like, you know, did a great job of playing off of that making that makeup even more than it was. So yeah, she had her fingers in a lot of Full Moon stuff at that time. Like I said, she was working for me at one point, and she was, you know, we were all friends, Dave Parker and I, you know, we were all friends and colleagues, and Dave was making Dead Hate the Living right around the same time that I was making, I think I'd shot and edited Witch House 2 about the time he had made Dead Hate the Living, and then that wound up being, he largely cut most of that at my apartment after we had all sort of left Full Moon. We were still had all this unfinished business going on, so there was a lot of like, it was a very incestual sort of.
I think when we had Dave Parker on, we said that we were like, we know about when we're getting into the Tempe era of Full Moon here, that it's just sort of like, and I think this is a holdover from the Kushner lock too, where it was just like getting stuff put out, getting stuff made. And I think I said to David, like, do you remember other productions going on? Because it's just probably so many different things going on at the same time. And I don't remember if he said Witch House 2, but the fact that you're saying like it was a very incestuous thing, like 100%, like had you look at the chronology of movies produced by Charles Band, and you look at like the years of like 1999, 2000, 2001, and there's just so many IMDb credits of stuff.
Oh, no, there was so much overlapping stuff that it was, I mean, at one point we were doing posts on four different movies per month because he had Surrender Cinema titles going out and these kids movies were being delivered to Kushner Lock. Mm-hmm. And then there was regular Full Moon titles and then there would be oddball stuff in there. So, I mean, it was, and Dave at that time, prior to doing Dead Hate the Living, Dave Parker was their trailer guy. So, I mean, when I first started with him, when I had done Shrieker, you know, he cut the trailer for Shrieker and then brought it to me and I helped him do some of the sound work on, you know, the finishing work on it and all that. So we were all on the eighth floor of their, you know, building. They had the eighth and ninth floor, and So it was just a little hub of activity. There was like 20 people ultimately that were working for me in the post department, finishing all this stuff. And Dave was one of those people that was off doing the trailer stuff at that time. Wow. So it was very, we were, it's just hard for any of us to sort of like, oh, when did we do this? When did we do, we know we did it, but there's stuff that I don't even remember that we did. I was bringing in editors from out of state because we were just, you know, so anxious to get people. And so it was a very, you know, fruitful time, I guess. There was a lot of stuff going on.
So you'd been doing kind of the post-production fix-up work for a little bit and kind of producing and kind of keeping keeping a lot of plates spinning around this time. Is this the first Full Moon movie that you got to direct since kind of joining up?
It is, although it was not supposed to be. There were two other projects. The first thing, Charlie, he dangled it like a carrot over me because he knew that I had made movies and he knew that I wanted to continue making movies. So
sure.
He had this Film Monster series, which I had helped finish the post on Werewolf Reborn, which was directed by Jeff Burr, and obviously had cut some of Frankenstein Reborn, which was Dave Dakota. Mm-hmm. And he wanted to make a third one called The Mummy Reborn.
Yeah.
And so Doug Snoffer, who wrote Witch House 2, actually did write the script for The Mummy Reborn, and we had some great conceptual sketches, and we were getting close to the point where we were going to cast it, and I was going to head off to Romania to make it. And then he looked at the numbers of the first two and said, no, I think we're going to kill this series. So he gave me what was then called fear.com, which ultimately was made as Horror Vision. And that actually leads directly into Witch House 2, because he called me in at one point to have a meeting about fear.com. And we sat down in his conference room, and he starts talking about Witch House and how well Witch House had done for Hollywood Video and Blockbuster. And it came just in the wake of the Blair Witch Project. So it had rented like insane numbers. So he immediately hit me up with the, you know, would you like to direct Witch House 2? And I'm like, well, I thought we were going to make this other movie. And I'm like, well, okay. I mean, I'll, you know, sure, why not? You know, I wasn't necessarily interested in making a sequel to anything or a Witch House movie in particular, but I thought, you know, the plus of it was, hey, you're going to go to Romania for a month. So I'm like, I'll do that.
And how did you find working in Romania? We've talked a lot with people like Ted Nicolau and you know, about working in Romania in the early days of like just after the revolution, where the first American crew in the country. But you came in kind of 10 years after things have sort of settled down. How did you find the experience?
Well, I mean, the Castel Film, who was the production company that Charlie had helped start, but at the point that I was there, we were pretty much outcasts. Like, a lot of these movies had come through there, and they had since had like Highlander sequels and big budget movies from Hollywood had come there and spent a lot of money. So when Charlie wanted to come over there and do Witch House 2 for whatever it was, $125,000 or whatever we wound up spending, they weren't very motivated to do that. So it was sort of like a thing that they didn't necessarily take very seriously, as far as Castel. And really, that to correct you, actually, that was not Witch House 2 was not the last movie to be shot, last Full Moon movie to be shot.
Ah, my mistake.
That was Prison of the Dead, which was Dakota. Which I was actually at one point supposed to direct. The plan was I was going to stay there and do Witch House 2 and Prison of the Dead together, and Dave wound up taking. So anyways, just so you know.
Oh, that's good to know. That's good. When was that? Was that shortly after this, or was it a few years?
I think we were like crossing planes almost. Like,
oh, really?
You know, like,
okay.
Dave was heading there and I was heading back to the U.S. I mean, it was that close together. So I think we shot it February of 2000, so he must have been shooting in March of 2000, March, April, something like that.
Yeah, it looks like they came out within, these two movies came out within about a month of each other. So yeah, all right. That's,
So JR, you mentioned the Blair Witch Project before as something that was looming large as an independent release and really positively affected the rentals on the first Witch House. It has an indelible influence on Witch House 2, obviously. So I want to know a little bit about your thought process in the way that you wanted to handle sort of the found footage aspect of this movie, because if I'm not mistaken, a portion of it is shot on 35 millimeter. And then how did you achieve the sort of camcorder effects, and who, like, was it your initial instinct to jump from camcorder to 35 millimeter? Was there ever a time when you thought you would tackle it as like an entirely found footage type movie? Like, just take us through a little bit the process of how you wanted to shoot that movie.
Well, there was some early discussion with Charlie that we were going to shoot it on video, on some form of video, the whole movie on some sort of video. So I think that was where a lot of that sort of came in. I'm like, well, if we're going to have to shoot it on video, maybe I'll frame it in that sort of way. I was not a huge fan of the Blair Witch Project. I appreciated, of course, what it was and the success that it had, but it didn't, it's not like I saw that and said, oh my gosh, I got to do the same thing. I was more actually almost parodying it to some degree in Witch House 2, or that was my, you know, what was going through my head. I just thought it was a plot device more than, you know, the actual whole story. But really, it also, when the decision was made to shoot on 35, the thing a lot of people don't realize, when Charlie Band says you're going to shoot a movie on 35, he's only giving you the bare minimum amount of film that you need to do it. Like, maybe you can do two or three takes and that's it. So I thought by doing some of the stuff on video, by framing it in that way, it would be a way so that I can maximize the film that I had for the performances and for, you know, to make the 35 millimeter parts of it better by doing, you know, more, having more footage to play with. And then I could kind of go nuts with the camcorder stuff, because that was all shot on mini DV with my own personal mini DV camera that I had taken to shoot some behind the scenes footage. I have hours of behind. I was literally like directing scenes and holding the camera up over the monitor to, you know, just trying to capture what was going on. There was nobody. I mean, a few times I think I handed it off to a Romanian production assistant or whatever and asked them to do it, because that's the only way that I would actually be in any of it. But I had convinced the cast in that one scene where the kids go into the house at the end and the lights are all off and all that. That was all shot after hours, because the crew had basically wrapped and wanted out of there, or they wanted to all go home. So I enabled it so a way that I could, you know, with one of the producers, stay there and shoot that stuff with them. And the cast all agreed to do it, because they were all, I was behind schedule too. That was the other thing, because I watch footage. So this was a nice way to get back on schedule. And to his credit, my cinematographer, Gabi Kosuth, who came up with the amazing look of the movie, he insisted on staying as well and helping shoot it. So he and I were basically the entire crew, and I was doing most of the camera work and all that with it. But so it was two things. It was a plot device, Blair Witch style, and it was all because that was sort of the thing that was in vogue at the time. And it was also a way to maximize the amount of film that I was given, so that I could use that film for, you know, better performances in a better movie. That was the idea.
Yeah.
Well, so I'm sure Charlie Band appreciates your clever, you know, usage of the film there, and trying to get the most bang for your buck there. If we know anything about his model of filmmaking, I'm sure he appreciated how to the point, you know, a lot of that was, and how you were pretty economical with stuff like that, it seems.
Yeah.
Well, there's an interesting side story if you'd like to hear it.
Please.
When Blair Witch opened huge that first weekend, that following Monday, Charlie was calling everybody into his office saying, we got to do something like this. Let's get some ideas. So we all, Dave Parker, myself, everybody was pitching him ideas. And that actually led to a movie called The St. Francisville Experiment. I don't know if you are familiar with that one. It was Kushner Locke basically got involved and eventually took it over. My company did all the post work on it, but it was another one of these found footage things where they spent a ridiculous amount of money trying to make something that looked and sounded like Blair Witch Project. But they ultimately took it out of Charlie's hands and just did whatever they wanted with it. But I think Ted Nicolau was the one who actually directed most of that under a pseudonym.
I've heard that name. I wasn't too familiar with the movie, but I was familiar. I think I've seen that on like DVD.
That is a full moon movie, so to speak.
Yeah, it was 90%, and then kind of yeah. I mean, all right. So it sounds like that was more of a Charlie demand to have it be a Blair Witch style than your own creative choice.
No. Actually, I take that back. No, he definitely did not inspire me to do. In fact, I think he probably would have preferred that I did not do that. There's scenes where the kids are driving around. I really wanted to open it up, because so many of these full moon movies, you only ever see the inside of wherever they're at, and maybe an establishing shot of the building.
Sure.
I wanted to show the kids out actually like interviewing the locals and see the scenery. I mean, even though it's sort of drab and bleak at times, especially in February, you know, in Romania is not a time to show it. But that Charlie actually, that was the only thing he really didn't like about the movie is some of that footage of the kids driving around in the van and you know, I had intercut all the footage out the window or whatever. He was like, ah, Romania looks so ugly. You got to get rid of that. I'm like, no, it's what we have. So.
But I think that was really a smart thing to do. Sorry, Steve. I think that was a smart thing to do because, like, I think one of our main criticisms is that Witch House, the first movie, felt a lot like a bunch of people standing around a singular location talking about how something scary may or may not be happening and not showing you a whole bunch. And then this one, immediately, the scale of it is bigger. And we're outdoors. We're getting some, like you said, some shots of rural Romania. You know, it doesn't, you know, yes, it is very drab, I think was a good word. But again, you get a sense of country and space and stuff that you don't get just with an establishing shot. I mean, you definitely have people in this movie going from place to place, which is a benefit and something that makes it already more enjoyable. Because like you were saying, JR, there are a lot of these, there's a lot of single location Yes. ultra cheap full moon movies, and they really feel like even ones that are on the like just B movie budget scale feel like micro budget. And I guess the reason why you got as the sort of like the chairman of the Tempe era and the patron saint of micro budgets, you managed to take the small budget here and make something that at least has a sense of scope and a sense of place and characters that can go to and from different places and locations. And so like that was appreciated right away. Just kind of the scale of it felt so much different than a lot of the cheapies, you know, that a few of them we've covered for the show.
Yeah.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah. I mean, that was the thing. It comes at a cost though, because like I remember the first day on Witch House 2, the very first thing we shot is the two kids driving the van, you know, and that's again, something you don't see in a lot of the full moon movies of that era, as people driving around. Well, there's a reason for that, because you're towing the vehicle and you're burning film, doing coverage from like the front of the window and through the, you know, the sides of the window. You're just burning film and you're burning time. And I spent half a day probably just of that first day shooting those driving scenes, to the point where I was immediately behind. By the end of the first day, I was already behind schedule. You know, I think I was at one point I was a day and a half or something behind schedule. And so you got to make that up somewhere, and you're only talking about, you know, 8 or 9 days, I think, if that. I think it was 7 or 8 actually.
Wow.
That we actually shot in Romania. So it's very hard to, every time you have to go from one location to another, you got to tear equipment down and move it and set it up somewhere else. You just burn time. That's what you're doing. So,
and the 8 days thing too, JR, like that's like some of these movies, like you'll watch it and you'll read this was shot in 8 days and you go, yeah, that tracks. For this one, it was like I read it and I went, wow, only 8 days. Okay, like we got some locations here. Like that's pretty, there's some good coverage there.
It's not an easy thing to do, that's for sure. So, but my reach has always exceeded my grasp. Anybody who's seen The Dead Next Door will know that. or really most of any of my movies. But yeah, I had seen, because of being post supervisor, I had seen so many of these movies come through that I would pinpoint, I wish they had done that. I wish they had done that. And it's not that anybody did anything wrong or that they were at fault. It's just I made mental notes like, if I make one of these, I'm going to do this, 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 and this.
Sure.
Just because I'm insane, you know.
There you go. I was really curious about the man on the street interviews that you got in this movie. These were so wild and so funny. And was this all improvised? It had a very improv-y spirit to it. And you had some real characters in here. Like, the guy who I was quoting at the beginning who kept going on about comic books is such a specific character. Was that just that person? Was that a character that somebody was doing? Like,
John Adams, who had made Sleepwalker / Vengeance.
Oh, is it? Okay.
And his partner, Harry Picardi, is the guy that comes, the angry guy comes out with his bike out of the apartment. That was those. They're both in there.
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember who else I put in there. Ted Newsom, who had made the Videomaker series for Charlie Band. He was in there, unfortunately no longer with us. Dave Parker, as you mentioned, Jeff Burr, of course. I think I have my friends Dave and Sandra Lang. Sandra was the post supervisor. She stayed around to be the post supervisor after I left. and her husband, Dave, who had, he's the one who created the Robot Ninja character from my second movie, Robot Ninja, but he was one of my CG guys. He did a lot of the, in fact, he did, I think, all the visual effects on Witch House 2, come to think of it. So they were in there as well. And there's probably a few others. But,
well, there was a guy I recognized, and thank God for Mystery Science Theater 3000, because it is the way in which I consumed a lot of B movies early in my like adolescence and young adulthood. And the guy who is being interviewed, who's the security guard, he was from one of my favorite Mystery Science Theater episodes, Soul Taker.
Oh, yeah.
He plays like the friend of the main character who's in the car with them when they have the accident. He ends up getting killed, spoiler alert, in a convenience store scene in that movie. But I thought that was such a perfect inclusion, because I've always felt, I mean, when you watch Mystery Science Theater, the mostly it's either a lot of old monster movies or some just really like incomprehensible stuff, or something with a hilarious central performance like Robot Holocaust.
Right.
Yeah. That you watch. But every once in a while, they take on a pretty competently made little indie movie that kind of works outside of the riffing. Mm-hmm. And Soul Taker is one of those movies where I feel like it's one of the better movies they've done, where it's like the movie kind of works. The premise is neat. It's a low budget, so it's bound by restrictions on budget and time and all that stuff. But it's a neat little idea that I think Vivian Schilling, who wrote and directed that movie, did like a pretty good job. And like, I saw that guy's face and I'm like, that's Tommy from Soul Taker, 100%. Yeah. And so I was happy to see him in there. And to add to your point, Steve, the comic book guy, he just gave me for some reason the vibes of the like sidekick guy in American Movie.
I was thinking exactly of American Movie. Yeah, that's what he was giving me right there. I'm just like, yeah, this is the exact vibe. And I was really on board with that. I mean, no, I had a lot of fun with this movie. I think it is propulsively paced. It goes to some weird and fun places. It has a lot of campy performances that I really enjoyed. I love that we get introduced to Ariana Albright as a horror hostess named Dementia. Is that right? Yeah, the really fun, really camping it up and having a good time. And yeah, it was just nice, you know, coming to this and seeing like, all right, yeah, we're really playing with the premise and we're really getting out there and doing a lot of fun stuff. Now, when you signed on for Witch House 2, was it a double deal to do Witch House 3 as well? Or did that just kind of happen after the first one came together so well?
No, it was a one-off deal. It was, you know, I mean, the plan was we were always going to make Horror Vision is probably the next one, or Fear.com. Mm-hmm. I don't think it was called that yet. But the thing that Witch House 2 got me was Charlie was impressed enough that then when I approached him about maybe doing trying a series of DV cam movies, shooting them on video, he was very receptive to the idea, because he knew at that point, even though I had not technically produced Witch House 2, I had brought a lot to it, even being in Romania. You know, I had done, you know, and of course all the posts and everything. So he knew that I could make an entire movie, even with really without anybody else. So that led us to making, Horror Vision, Stitches, The Vault, and Groom Lake, which were the next four that came after that. And those were all co-produced with me, along with me, by Chuck Williams, who played that security guard that you were mentioning, Jared. So
there you go. It all ties together. It's such a small community.
So there was a number of movies in between that before, but there was no talk of a Witch House 3 until at least probably a year and a half later, maybe.
Okay.
And we're transitioning from 35mm and DV cam mixed to just shooting on DV cam then for Witch House 3. So Steve, why don't you take this opportunity to fire off some Witch House 3 stats for our listeners?
For sure. Witch House 3 Demon Fire was released October 16th, 2001, again directed by J.R. Buchwalter and written by J.R. Buchwalter and Matthew Jason Walsh. And it stars Debbie Rochon, Tanya Dempsey, Tina Krause, Paul DiRigo, Michael Deak, and the great Brink Stevens. Very excited. You know, we have a couple of B movie luminaries here that have come up on our show many, many times, in some cases as guests by the time people have heard this. Brink Stevens, we all know and love. as well as Michael Deake, the eternal stand-in. The anytime you need a monster in a full moon or Empire movie, Michael Deake is there to put on a big rubber mask. Really great that he's in there. But we've also
Michael Deake actually did not work on Witch House 3. I'm not sure.
Oh, really?
That on the IMDb, because yeah, he was not in it. We couldn't afford him.
Oh, well, that's fair. He is listed as an uncredited cameo in Witch House 3. So that is a good correction. I'm going to get on IMDb and fix that.
I'm trying to think what that could have been, but no, I don't think so.
Interesting. Huh. Okay, good to know. There we go. We have our first scoop here, Michael. But, you know, hey, Michael Deake still looks great in a rubber suit.
I want to take credit, but he has so many credits. I guess he doesn't need that one.
Right.
Yeah. Hit delete on those angry tweets.
We're getting it. We're there.
We make mistakes as well. I'm really excited that we get to talk about Debbie Rochon.
That was
the first time on the show.
One of the kind of more noteworthy B movie scream queens of the 90s and 80s is Debbie Rochon. She has more than 263 credits to her name at this point. So that girl just works. She's a Vancouver. She started from a very troubled past in Vancouver. She was like homeless and living on the street when she was a kid. And she transitioned that into becoming a pretty respected New York theater actress. And then she became kind of a mainstay of these mega low budget films, a lot of erotica stuff, a lot of like horror stuff. She worked with Troma quite a bit. I think the first time I ever saw her was in Tromeo and Juliet, which was written by James Gunn. She played the Romeo and Juliet equivalent of the nurse in that one. She was a heavily tattooed, beautiful lesbian woman who was taking care of Juliet. That's a fun movie. If people haven't seen that, it's deeply bizarre, a lot of fun. And I'm actually surprised she does not show up more on our show. As near as I can tell, the only two movies she worked on for Full Moon were this movie and Killjoy 2. Is that, I'm not sure if, I mean, it's really hard to parse with like really long film credits that both Full Moon and Debbie Rochon have. But these were the two that jumped out to me when I was looking through her IMDb.
There were a couple more. We did Witch House 3, Killjoy 2, Dead and Rotting, which was directed by my childhood friend, David Barton. That was made back here in Ohio.
Oh, cool.
That was a Full Moon movie. And then technically I was one of the producers, although uncredited, on Bleed, which she was also in.
Oh, very cool. Okay. So
also has a voice cameo as the police dispatcher in Deadly Stingers / Mega Scorpions, which was my last Full Moon effort. So there's a few more in there.
Well, I'm looking forward to when we get to Bleed. It's got a cover that it's one of the ones I haven't seen the movie, but in my subsequent reads, if it came from the video aisle or perusing through, you know, IMDb for future episodes, every time I see the cover of Bleed, I'm like, I really hope we get to that one soon.
Yeah, we'll definitely get to that one.
It's an interesting story by now, and yeah, for sure.
That's a Devin Hamilton who did Delta Delta Die, which we talked about already, which we had a lot of fun with. How did you find working with Debbie Rochon? Obviously, you came back, worked with her a few more times. I always thought she just seemed like really cool and very like confident and fun in these movies.
Yeah, well, that was the funny thing, because Debbie and I had known each other for years. We had met at Chiller Theater conventions, I think, originally out east. So it was funny, though, to bring her and Tina Krause, both from the East Coast. Mm-hmm. And then I had two West Coast girls, Brink Stevens and Tanya Dempsey, you know, to bring them into this movie together was sort of an interesting dynamic. But no, I mean, Debbie's great. She takes a very blue collar approach to acting. Now, these are her own words that she says. She just likes working and she likes doing stuff and she likes the challenge of making even something that's not very good into something that could be better. So we hit it off very well because we both see the, you know, the B movie stuff is the same way, I guess, you know,
which is like, awesome
on the show and let's do it, you know, and she's just so easy to work with that. Yeah. That was the thing. It's like, you want to bring her back because you know what you're going to get, even though we had, you know, at the budgets of those movies at the time that we were getting into, you know, bringing somebody out from New York, you know, you're talking about a plane ticket and then a hotel, you know, costs. So you're eating money by doing that when you're, you know, here I'm in Los Angeles where you could practically trip over actors on the sidewalk every day. But Witch House 3 was made. We didn't really go through a casting process. I knew who I wanted. I wanted Tanya Dempsey because Tanya had been in Shrieker, which was the first Full Moon movie that I edited. And she's also great. So it was all really just like plucking people out of like, oh, I want this person, this person, this. That was the casting process. Like, we're done, you know, because it's a small cast too. So
I was glad to hear you vocalize like that. That's the thing that we've always hit on this show. And like the reason why we enjoy looking at Full Moon movies in particular is because there is a real let's put on a show kind of vibe to the whole enterprise. Like, and that's why we have so much affection for a lot of these movies. Is it's honestly a Muppet approach to horror in the best possible way. It is like, we have enthusiasm for this medium, we like our friends, we want to get together and make something and just get it out there and just keep working. So it's cool to hear somebody who's been involved with Full Moon echo that sentiment, because we've always kind of identified it.
Yeah, and if you're casting something as small as essentially the four-hander that Witch House 3 is, it's like you can, you're not really out there trying to pitch it to too many people. It's like, oh, I want Debbie Rashawn and I want so-and-so and so-and-so. You don't have a lot of roles to fill. And then, you know, the interesting casting choice to me for such a, I don't want to say underutilized, because that's a negative, and I'm not trying to be negative about it, but a very small kind of background role for Brink Stevens. What brought her on board for this movie?
Well, Brink, I mean, I've known Brink since 1990. I think I had cut this series called Shock Cinema for David Dakota's Cinema Home Video years ago, and that's how we first met. Mm. And we've been friends, and we've always been looking for an opportunity to do something together. So, Ariana did not want to play Lilith again. So it was then became, well, who would I want to play Lilith? And it's like, well, Brink Stevens, you know, I mean, yeah. There's nobody here. I didn't even have to think about it. It was just like, I called her up and she said yes. And that was it. So, I mean, that it was that simple. It was, you know, there was nothing more complicated than that. Cause that's the thing. It's like the Witch House 2 and 3, they're almost polar opposites in far as how they were made and the way they were made and the money that we had to, I mean, you know, Witch House 2, we went through the whole usual Full Moon casting process. They had Bob and Perry, the casting guys who were on staff, and we did the whole, you know, brought everybody in and read them, and, you know, spent weeks doing that. Witch House 3, we didn't do any of that because we didn't have time or money to do it. And I believe Bob and Perry may not have even been on staff at that point. So there was nobody to do the casting. We had to do it ourselves. So it was better to just get the people, you know, you have to go with the people you know can do it, and, you know, so that you're off and running and you're not spending too much time trying to chase people that maybe aren't going to work out.
Right. Yeah. I mean, yeah, this is all three Witch House movies have very different tones and very different styles. And this one is really stripped down. It's just kind of a handful of characters, only about like 6 or 7 people in the entire cast, really. And it's kind of a paranoid thriller with supernatural elements to it, which is really cool. I like that you're kind of the characters are at least questioning. It's like, okay, is this a supernatural thing that's going on, or is this the abusive boyfriend who they're trying to escape from? So, like, I enjoyed that kind of paranoid element of it that this one brought. This one was a fun watch. I thought all the actresses were really locked in and having a good time.
Yeah, I think this one was probably more, I won't say that it was inspired by The Craft. It's a movie, not a movie that I have a particular fondness for, but it's in terms of, if I was going to riff on something, it was probably, you know, because Debbie's playing this goth character, which she's the complete opposite of that in real life, you know, but so she's got that look and feel to it. So, but it was, yeah, it was, it, we were really just trying to tell, it's almost more, I call it more of a soap opera movie with a witch in it. It's like, because you're really getting into the interpersonal relationships of the three main girls and the abusive boyfriend, of course. So it was an opportunity, because it was being made so small and so cheaply, that it was like we could basically just do anything with it. And I don't know if you know the backstory of how I came to make Witch House 3. There was actually another movie starring Tanya Dempsey that Charlie was thinking about picking up, and it was called The Coven. It was produced by Dave Sterling, who's done tons and tons of this kind of stuff. And I think Brad Sykes was the director on it. But they had shot this using this consumer 3D format or whatever. So somehow this had crossed Charlie's desk, and he thought, oh, I could buy this outright and retitle it Witch House 3 and call it a day. So he gave it to me from a strictly a quality controls aspect, like can I release this? Is it, can this be done? What, you know, what is the technical quality like? And the technical quality was not great. And he was going to pay like $15,000 for this movie out to buy all the rights. And I had mentioned actually on out of just off the cuff to his right-hand guy, Mickey Kaiserman, I said, you know, for 15 grand, I'll go make you a new Witch House 3. It's like, I don't know, why is he picking up this? Because at that point, I think I was a little protective of the Witch House. You know, I had made the second one. I didn't make the first one, but at least I was like, you don't do this. This is too far step down. Like, let's just go make something new. So, well, of course, Mickey mentioned it to Charlie. And then that following Monday, I get called into Charlie's office and he's like, oh, so you want to make Witch House 3? I'm like, well, that's not quite what I said. But yeah. I will do it.
I'll take it. But I guess.
I did say I'll make, I can make three Witch House movies for $15,000.
No, thank God I didn't say that. So it was more of a dare. It was a dare movie, really. I mean, he sort of like dared me to come to do what I said that I could make it. I knew I could make it for 15 grand. That was never an issue.
Right.
It was because I've made things cheaper and I've made things for more money. But obviously at this point we were still shooting DV cam and I own the camera, you know, because I was basically bought the camera and I was renting it back to the production. So I had all the gear. We didn't really need much of anything to do it except actors, you know, and a script. Yeah. So anyways, yeah, that's how this even came to pass in the first place.
And did you have a comparable shooting schedule on this one? Was it the same like 7 or 8 day turnaround time?
Yeah, I think it was. I think it may have been 9 sticks in my head. I'm not sure why, but I think maybe it was 9 days, something like that.
Okay.
I mean, again, it was sort of like up to me, where Witch House 2, you know, he said, oh, you're going to shoot this many days in Romania. And I had to stick to it. Where Witch House 3, it was sort of like up to me, what can I afford to shoot? Because I wasn't really paying myself per se out of that 15 grand. I was going to have to make my money some other way.
Right. Yeah. So yeah.
I've been working for free. And actually when I went into it, I didn't even intend on putting my name on it. I was going to put some sort of other, it wasn't until I started cutting and I was like, you know, this isn't half bad. I can, I've made worse for certain ways.
And in Witch House 3, you brought, well, I say you, I don't mean you specifically. I mean, Full Moon and Charles Band brought back Matthew Jason Walsh to write the movie. And he had written the original Witch House movie. Was that like a conscious thing? Was it like purposeful to like bring him back? Or was it just, these are, you know, the writers that are under contract or easily accessible? Like, was there a specific reason why he was tapped instead of the writer? Because the writer on Witch House 2, that guy is someone we never talked, Douglas Snoffer, we never talked about on the show before. And
yeah,
so
he just passed away last year too. He had written The Mummy Reborn, which never got made. And that was, I think, his only two screen credits. But Doug had been actively involved in Ohio in the movies that I had made here. He had helped produce some of them. Okay. That's where he came from. And Matt actually started with me. I was the sort of one that discovered him in a personals ad in Fangoria magazine. Back in the days when you would get a subscription, they let you put a little personal ad in there. And Matt had put an ad seeking somebody to help get his movie made. So I had contacted him, and this was back, I was still in Ohio. So this was 91, 92, maybe. Maybe it was earlier than that even. But I contacted him and read his script, and I thought, oh, this guy's really got something. So I hired him to write The Sandman, which, you know, didn't get made at that time, but I wound up making it years later. So Matt actually met Dave Dakota through me and wound up writing tons of stuff for Dave. And I think he still writes a lot of the Lifetime movies and all that kind of stuff that Dave does. So that's kind of how, you know, I was sort of responsible for Matt coming into the first Witch House. But Matt and I had for years, like, we would go periods of time where we didn't speak to each other or whatever. It's just the typical situation. And when you're making these movies and you're in the trenches with people, but I stopped, I think, in Kansas City where he was living at the time to interview him for something else. I think one of the DVD releases I was doing, and he took me to breakfast the next morning. He's like, I want to get back involved. So that was at the time where we were about to make Witch House 3. So I thought, well, this is perfect for him, for the idea that I have. And he pitched me and I pitched him. And so he really, I mean, he wrote the first draft and I think that was it. I did a rewrite to polish it up and get it exactly where it was more shootable. I think Matt tends to write these big endings that are impossible to pull off for the money. So I had to, I wanted it to be more of a personal ending where the girls literally, like, it just degenerates into a cat fight. That was kind of my big thing I wanted to end it with. So that was my contribution to it. But yeah, I mean, he actually came into it just because we had done so much other stuff together. I mean, his first screenwriting credit is Kingdom of the Vampire, which he also starred in, which we made in 91. So yeah, we went way back at that point. Even
I should have figured that it was another incestuous relationship of all of this stuff going on, because you mentioned also his work on like Hallmark or Lifetime movies. And it's just, that's another thing in like doing the show and talking to people, how it's just fascinating to see like the career trajectory for a lot of people also who kind of cut their teeth in like low budget movies and either like Empire or Full Moon or other comparable companies, because it's like a lot of these guys, like be it David Dakota or Sam Irvin or Fred Olin Ray, they all like went on to have this like prolific, like Lifetime movie or Hallmark movie career post like sci-fi horror stuff, which I find to just be so interesting that they all kind of went in that direction, and that they all probably, you know, ended up collaborating or at least having trading back and forth pieces of people to collaborate on projects that aren't Full Moon related after that. It's just, doing the show has been so fun in the sense where it's like you just get such a fun sense of the way that fraternity like atmosphere in some ways, where people kind of come and go, but these connections are made and they're all, even like 10, 15, 20 years will go by and they're still kind of all tied together. And it's you keep hearing the same names. It's great.
That's the thing though, with a lot of this, like, you know, like Dave Dakota, originally I stumbled into his path and made a bunch of movies for him. And then he's the one that wound up opening the door and got me into Full Moon. And then Charlie kept me where, you know, if you prove that you're reliable and you can do this stuff and do it well, people will just continue to hire you. The same way where I've hired Matt Walsh, Dave Dakota's hired Matt Walsh, Charlie's hired Matt Walsh for some stuff. I mean, that's just the way it works. It's not even, I call it incestual, but it's not even that. It's just, right. You know, it's just, people just wind up getting opportunities because you prove that you can do it. And I think that's even true today with the guys that you just mentioned doing all the Lifetime and Hallmark movies. I mean, it's the same situation. They want somebody that can go out there and do it for a price and deliver what they want. And that's how it gets done.
Yeah. Well, this was really cool to be able to talk to you about these two movies. It was really fun to watch it. Like, you know, I like I said, we're being overly mean to Witch House, but like we were really, I was really excited to see this series kind of find its footing in such a cool way. And, you know, obviously you're working with some budgetary limitations and things like that, but you really turned around something very cool, I think. I think you could really see kind of the filmmaker spirit shining through there, which I really, really appreciated. And we had a great time watching these and a great time talking to you about it. So
thanks. Yeah, no, I mean, that was like I said, that was always the effort to try and do something different with this, whatever you're handed, you know, you want to do the best you can with it.
Absolutely. So that's the best like ethos to have about making these movies. And I think that really comes through. Do you have anything that you're working on right now that you'd like to share? Anything you'd like to plug or direct people towards?
Well, it's I actually sort of stepped out of it for about 20 years after making this giant scorpion movie for Charlie Band and Full Moon, which ultimately sat dormant for many years and finally was released to his streaming services. That was kind of the thing that drove me not completely out of the business, because I was still distributing and doing a lot of post work and other things, but it squashed my desire to make anything else or direct anything else. But last year I came out of the so-called forced retirement to make a movie called Side Effects May Vary, which is now hitting streaming and available on disc. And that it has a lot of the same people. Tina Kraus and Briggs Stevens from Witch House 3 are both in that movie. Debbie Rochon has another voice cameo in it as well. So it's a lot of had sort of weirdly made it with people from all the different filmmaking eras that I'd done. I had a couple people from the early, early days, a couple people from the middle era, and a couple people from the Full Moon era. So if you're into any of those Full Moon movies, there's definitely some, you know, something to be seen in the new one as well.
Oh, very cool. And that has an amazing poster art that I was just looking at. I love the poster art that you have on that. The big green bottle looks so cool, and the little zombie guy.
Yeah, I just spent 6 months traveling the country showing it theatrically.
Very cool.
Even wound up in Canada and Germany for film festivals and where it played. And the audience reception so far has been great. So I think if you're into goofy, incredible Melting Man type of movies, that's the one to beat this year. Is Side Effects May Vary.
Oh, I don't think that would appeal to people who listen to our show.
No,
frankly,
never.
No. I think
certainly not.
No, never.
Incredible Melting Man, Brink Stevens. These are words that elicit no reaction to our yes. listener base whatsoever. And it's like, I did want to just mention just a little spoiler on Mike. Like, if you're a fan of Brink Stevens, like all of us are, you may get to hear her voice pretty soon. I won't yeah. say a whole lot more, but you might get to hear her voice pretty soon. JR, I don't
Or depending on when we release this, you may have heard it already. I don't know.
This is true. Yeah, our release schedule a little wonky with recordings, but JR, I don't do this that often, but I figure this is probably as good a time as any, because you know, you wrote a book that so detailedly chronicles like what it takes to get, you know, a passion project made when you don't have a lot of the resources, but you have the desire and the drive to get things done. So like, to anybody, because you're sort of, like we've said, you're considered this person who's been able to sort of a miracle worker with micro budgets and taking a little and making something that stands on its own and transcends the budget and the production and time limitations. Is there any like advice that you would give to like people, fledgling independent filmmakers who maybe are like, I have an idea, I have this thing I want to do, but I don't have access to financing, to sponsorship, to, you know, an executive producer to get some funds for me. Like, what kind of advice would you give someone who is just thinking right now about following their dream to make some low budget movies?
My initial response would be to go get a job and forget about it, because the film industry has never been. It's not a film business anymore. It's a film hobby. Now, that said, if you really want to do it and nothing's going to stop you, which I tell everyone that they should do it. You know, if you have that burning desire, nothing should stop you from doing it. But I mean, really, the technology has finally caught up to where I hoped it would have been in the early 90s. I mean, you literally can make a really good looking feature film with an iPhone and a group of friends and a few lights. So there's nothing stopping you from doing it. You don't need big money. I mean, just write an idea that you can do, you know, that's practical to do at for that budget. And if anything, I mean, that was the thing going back to Witch House 3, you know, we had a budget and we wrote something that fit that budget. That's the best advice I can give somebody is don't, you know, if you're going to have something that's set in outer space with an alien and face huggers and all that stuff, you're probably not going to pull it off for $10,000 or $15,000, but you don't even need to spend that kind of money anymore. I mean, it just, you know, you'll have a heck of a time getting anybody to see it, because audiences now, everybody wants to wait for Tubi to see something. So, you know, good luck with trying to build an audience from physical media or any of that kind of stuff. With new movies, it just doesn't happen anymore. There's nowhere to find the stuff, but you should never let any of that stop you. If you really want to make a movie, you have to do it because you want to do it. And yeah. you're not doing it because you want to make money, because there's better ways to make money. My son makes better money. He's 15 years old. He's working full time this summer at Wendy's. He's probably making better money than I would if I made a movie right now.
I could say the same for people podcasting right now. Yes. Very true.
Everything's been, there's so many, there's fewer opportunities and more people doing it.
That's true.
This is very true. Although I will say, if David the Rock Nelson taught me anything, it's that you can make a movie with aliens and spaceships in it for nothing. and it's going to get the point across. I don't know. That's a really like niche thing for anybody who knows, like Conrad Brooks versus the werewolf type stuff.
and he's done it for years. So yes, it can be done.
Well, listeners, I hope that you enjoyed the episode on Witch House 2 and 3. If you like what we do, then you can jump onto Spotify or Apple Podcasts. Drop us a little 5-star rating, maybe a brief review if you feel so inclined to do so. If you want to keep up with the show on social media, you can follow our official Instagram at puppetmasters_castlefreaks. You can follow me at _giallo_Jerry or Steve at Minotaur Matador. We're also on X, maybe Blue Sky and Threads, something will pop up on there, but I know there are some people who watch who listen to the show on YouTube, even though YouTube is just like a thumbnail and the audio file. We are aware of that, and we will try to make some YouTube content in the near future, but for now I know you can find the episodes on there as well if you just search the name of the show. This is not the only show though that Steve would like to take the opportunity to plug, so Steve, what else have you got going on?
Absolutely. I also am the host of a show called Cinemarcade, which is cinema and arcade mashed together because that's what we do. We are talking about movies and then playing their video game adaptations to see how they complement or contradict each other. We have a lot of fun digging into both mediums and seeing how they collide. Again, my schedule is way off from the Castle Freak schedule, so we're not entirely sure where we're at. But I know right now in real time, we're recording a Jumanji miniseries talking about each of the movies in that franchise and the games that were adapted from them. So that's going to be pretty fun. And I know I'm fairly confident we have a Friday the 13th episode coming up very shortly. If you are into hearing about masked killers, which I can't imagine you would be on this show. So our next episode, speaking of killers, we've got a killer episode about a killer. Look at that. That works out really beautifully. That was a perfect segue.
Beautifully done.
The Hall of Fame, because we are going to be talking about a movie from 1986 called Crawl Space. This is from Empire Pictures, and it is a weirdly important movie for Full Moon in particular. We'll get into why, as well as one of the craziest actor on set stories that you will ever encounter. Looking forward to digging into all of that. So check out our episode next week on Crawl Space.
Yeah, we're not going to include it in the episode description, but there will probably be some talk of a and analysis of a short form documentary that may or may not go along with this movie.
Yeah,
we won't advertise it as part of the episode name, but it definitely will be referenced, I'm sure. So listeners, we will see you next week for Crawl Space with a very fun return guest that I'm sure everyone is going to be happy about. Again, thank you to J.R. Bookwalter for taking the time and lending your insight. Make sure that you go to any streaming service and search Side Effects May Vary. And while you're at it, go back and check out his entire low-budget film catalog and watch, you know, somebody really make a lot of interesting stuff with super limited budgets and time. It's a really impressive filmography. So thank you again, JR, and we'll see you next time for Crawl Space.